Good morning, I'm Nikki De Guzman. Here are the stories that made it to ANC's rundown. Philippine President-elect Ferdinand Marcos Jr. names his national security and agrarian reform picks. A survivor of the Texas school massacre tells Congress about what she had to do to save her life. And the World Health Organization has confirmed over 1,000 cases of the monkeypox virus. Retired political science professor Clarita Carlos is appointed by Philippine President-elect Marcos to be his national security advisor. Dr. Carlos was once the president of the National Defense College and previously acted as the government's consultant in peace talks with the Moro Islamic Liberation Front. Marcos also chose House Deputy Speaker Conrado Estrella III to lead the Agrarian Reform Department. The Abono Party List representative is the grandson of Conrado Estrella Sr., who once served as the Agrarian Reform Minister in the administration of the President-elect's father. Both accepted the offer to join the incoming administration. Bagong Alyansang Makabayan urges the police to respect the rights of the people to conduct rallies during the President-elect Marcos's inauguration. The Progressive Group Secretary General Renato Reyes says the incoming administration needs to hear the grievances of people on the ground. He also asserts rallies without a permit should not be violently dispersed. Earlier, authorities announced so-called illegal rallyists will not be allowed near the National Museum on Marcos's inauguration.
The authorities are fixated on the concept of no permit, no rally. So anything that takes place without a permit, they think they have the grounds to violently disperse and suppress the people. So impunity yung nangyayari, no? It has been this notion of the police that they can do anything so long as four protesters failed to present a permit. Our challenge to the incoming administration is just the image that you really like to project to the world, that on the first day of Mr. Marcos in office, you will be doing a reprise of the 1972 Marcos dictatorship where people are prevented from expressing themselves.
Outgoing and incoming Philippine leaders greet the Filipino-Chinese community as they mark the 21st Filipino-Chinese Friendship Day. President-elect Marcos hailed what he noted as the great gains from the Philippines' relationship with China. He said he looks forward to more fruitful engagements in the two countries' friendship.
The centuries-old relationship and friendship of the Philippines and China has been and will continue to be of great mutual benefit to our people. From trade, arts, culture, athletics, to regional peace and stability, to the employment of opportunities for our people, and all the significantly generous efforts extended to us during the pandemic, the cooperative partnership of our two nations continued to reach new heights.
Vice President-elect Sara Duterte spoke in a recorded message, which she hoped to achieve in new milestones with the Filipino-Chinese community. The celebration held via video conference also marked in advance the 124th anniversary of Philippine independence. Outgoing Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte sent a recorded greeting, saying the occasion should remind Filipinos how their forefathers fought for the freedom they enjoy today. Philippine Election Commissioner Socorro Inting back as the pool body's acting chairperson. That's after Sideman Pangarungan failed to secure the nod of the Commission on Appointments to keep his position as chairperson of the Election Commission. Commissioners Aimin Neri and George Garcia were also bypassed. Inting was the acting chairperson of the pool body before Pangarungan was appointed by President Duterte in March. The Commission on Elections begins preparing for the upcoming village and youth council polls this December. This despite reports the incoming administration may push for the postponement of the elections.
Naghahanda kami ng ating mga yung ating mga activity plans for the barangay elections, and we're already starting internal discussions on the various scenarios that we will be playing out. Hindi naman talaga nagre-recommend ng COMELEC, no, ng postponement, no. It's not something that we do. As far as the COMELEC is concerned, if the elections are in the books, if scheduled already, then we will go through with it.
The COMELEC also says the pandemic will be factored in as it prepares for the upcoming elections.
remember, nasa panahon pa rin tayo ng pandemya. And so we're still planning very carefully all of these procedures that we hope that will make the barangay elections safe.
Later, Representative Martin Romualdez, who is being pushed to be the next speaker, has said the House of Representatives is eyeing postponing the upcoming Village and Youth Council elections, this to save funds for a renamed stimulus bill. And other news, after the World Bank Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development sharply lowers its global growth forecast for 2022. The OECD sees the global economy growing 3% this year, down from its 4.5% estimate back in December. It also downgraded its forecast for the next year from a 3.2% expansion to just 2.8%. The main culprit, Russia's invasion of Ukraine.
The economic outlook we are presenting to you today is much more pessimistic than some months ago. Russia's war is indeed imposing a heavy price on the global economy. Global growth will be substantially lower with higher and more persistent inflation. Projections for consumer price inflation have been revised significantly upwards. We project inflation in 2022 to average 8.8% across the OECD before receding slowly in 2023 as supply chain and commodity price pressures wane and monetary policy measures continue to take effect.
The OECD adds the extent to which growth will be lower and inflation will be higher will ultimately depend on how the war evolves. But it says it is clear poorest nations will be hit the hardest. Transport regulators have approved a 1 peso fare hike for public utility jeepneys effective today, June 9. This is in response to a petition filed by transport groups amid the unabated rise in fuel prices. The fare increase will bring the base fare or the first 4 kilometers to 10 pesos. The fare hike is limited to the National Capital Region as well as Regions 3 and 4. Meanwhile, the regulatory board will hear a separate petition to increase the base fare by 5 pesos on June 28, the last week of the Duterte administration. Motorists again call on the Philippine government to suspend the excise tax on fuel as oil prices continue to rise. More from Alvin El Chico.
As fuel prices rose, worker Janelle has started to use his bicycle and decided to temporarily retire his motorcycle to minimize expenses.
Standby muna sa bahay kasi mahal yung gasolina ngayon eh. Mahirap yung buhay. Noong dati kasi magkano lang yun, nasa 50 lang yun eh, 53. Ngayon, wala, tumaas na ngayon. Magkano na ngayon ng 78 na ngayon. Mahirap ang buhay.
Gasoline now retails at 74 to 97 pesos per liter, while diesel is at 75 pesos to 90 pesos in Metro Manila. Bayan patrollers have also sent fuel prices in their areas where fuel now costs more than 80 pesos per liter. In Palawan, prices are now more than 90 pesos per liter. Motorists are asking the government to consider suspending the excise tax on petroleum.
Sana iano nila yung excise tax ng petrolyo para kahit paano matulungan yung mga katulad naming motorista.
Kung makakatulong sa pangkalahatan, okay lang po.
Mas okay po yung tanggalin muna yung tax para habang wala pa, at least mababa yung konsumo ng namin.
Removing excise tax means a slash of 10 pesos per liter for gasoline, 6 pesos for diesel, and 5 pesos for kerosene. If government decides to suspend the biofuels component of fuel, gasoline will be cheaper by 3 to 4 pesos per liter and diesel by 1 to 2 pesos per liter. But incoming Senate Ways and Means Committee Chairman Sherwin Gatchalian says it is better to increase the targeted help to the transport sector.
Kahit doblehin pa natin yan to about 6 billion, mas mura pa rin siya kaysa mawala yung 200 billion plus. So para sa akin, yan ang mas epesyente pa. Pero hindi ko rin sinasarayin isip ko sa pagtatanggal ng excise tax, Alvin, lalo na kung humaba itong gera.
Gatchalian is not in favor of raising income tax but is studying the possibility of raising taxes on non-essential goods and services. The senator says the BIR should resolve collection efficiency issues, but when asked if the tax bureau should collect the tax on the Marcos estate, Gatchalian insists the issue is political.
political ploy nga yun, yung narrative na yun eh, no? Lumabas lang ng politika and obviously politika story ang politika at pang-politika lang 'yun. Makikita ho natin lumabas pa yan sa mga katunggaling kandidato, no? At kung mayroong ganyan nga, dapat lumabas sa bibig ng BIR yan, lumabas sa bibig ng DOF.
Finance Secretary Carlos Dominguez earlier said the government is bent on collecting any tax due on the Marcos estate. Alvin Olchico, ABS-CBN News.
A group of transport advocates urges the incoming Marcos administration to appoint transportation officials who have genuine concern for Filipinos. Outmobility PH says the country needs leaders who will break the cycle of focusing on projects that only benefit owners of private vehicles while overlooking the needs of commuters, pedestrians, and cyclists. It adds, officials should swiftly respond to issues hounding the transport sector, including rising oil prices. The group also calls for better transport policies and better public transportation facilities in the Philippines. Agriculture Secretary William Dar says an additional 9 billion pesos is needed to sustain rice production in the country this wet season. He says the funds will be used for fertilizer subsidies for farmers. Dar earlier warned of a possible 6 peso per kilo increase in the price of rice by the end of the year due to high cost of production. This will make it harder for the incoming Marcos administration to achieve its goal of selling rice for as low as 20 pesos per kilo.
I have yet to understand the assumptions of the math. Because it all points out it will take some time before we can go to that near 20 pesos. I am for working the program design and the solutions through value chain approach to make it possible to go near 20 pesos. Mm-mm. But when you say the timeline is to produce it and sell rice early 2023, 20 pesos po, then you have to heavily subsidize.
Patmak Sasaka, Party List Representative Argel Kabatbat, agrees with the Agrarian Reform Department that rice prices can be lowered by 2023.
The aspiration of the incoming president is to have a 20 to 30 pesos price of rice. And for your information, the 30 pesos per kilo has already been achieved by the provincial government of Nueva Ecija when Governor Umayi put up this provincial food council that directly bought palay from our local farmers in Nueva Ecija and sold it directly to the consumers. Another pilot project in Tarlac, now extending to Nueva Ecija, ito po yung dinidiscuss ni Secretary Bernie Cruz ng DAR about Mega Farms Project. They were able to guarantee 36,000 per hectare net income to the local farmers. Mm-mm. We can really do that with the political will, with the necessary policy changes, and of course, budgetary support.
The latest now on the war in Ukraine. Russia rejects suggestions grain stuck in Ukrainian ports was fueling a global food crisis. Moscow's invasion of Ukraine has not only devastated farmlands, but also disrupted crucial deliveries. Ukrainian President Volodymyr Zelensky said on Monday about 20 to 25 million tons of grain were currently blocked in Ukrainian ports that could grow to 70 to 75 million tons in the autumn. But the Kremlin disputes that figure, saying the grain reserves are being exaggerated and that are too small to have an impact. Russia has repeatedly denied blocking the passage of cargo ships loaded with Ukrainian grain. It instead blames Western sanctions for contributing to the food crisis. Russia and Ukraine produce 30% of the global wheat supply. In the U.S., an 11-year-old girl relives the horrors of last month's school shooting in Texas before a panel of lawmakers. Maya Cerillo, a fourth grader at Robb Elementary School in Uvalde, recounted terrifying details of the moments when 19 of her schoolmates and two of her teachers were killed by an 18-year-old gunman. Cerillo also recalled what she had to do to survive the massacre.
He shot my friend that was next to me. And I thought he was gonna come back to the room. So I grabbed the blood and put it all over me. And
What did you do then when you put the blame on yourself?
Just stay quiet, and then I got my teacher's phone and called 911.
And what did you tell 911?
I told her that we need help and to send the police in our classroom.
Cirilio is still healing from bullet fragment wounds in her back and wrestling with trauma from the incident. She fears a mass shooter could target her school again. The House Oversight and Reform Committee also heard from relatives of the victims of the mass shooting in Buffalo, New York.
If after hearing from me and the other people testifying here today does not move you to act on gun laws, I invite you to my home to help me clean Zaire's wounds so that you may see up close the damage that has been caused to my son and to my community.
Congressional Democrats have been pressing for action and calling for stricter gun control in the wake of the mass shootings. An armed man who made threats against Brett Kavanaugh has been arrested near the Supreme Court justice's home. The Justice Department has charged him with attempting or threatening to kidnap or murder the U.S. judge. The development comes as a high court prepares to release potentially landmark judgments on politically charged cases on abortion and gun rights. Initial evidence indicates the man was angry about a leaked draft opinion that indicated the court could be poised to overturn federal protections for abortion rights. The man was also angry about the recent spate of mass shootings in the country. The court is expected to rule before the end of the month on a New York firearms case that could see it effectively loosen gun control laws. Amid high tensions on the rulings, the White House says U.S. President Joe Biden strongly condemns in the strongest terms the threats against Kavanaugh. And we're taking a quick break. Still to come, Moderna reports positive results for a vaccine specifically targeting the Omicron variant. That's next on The Rundown. Stay tuned. Moderna says its new COVID-19 booster provides stronger protection against the Omicron variant. The so-called bivalent vaccine was tested in a trial of 814 adults and was shown to produce 1.75 times more Omicron-specific neutralizing antibodies compared to Moderna's original COVID jab. The group that got the new shot also received slightly superior protection to the ancestral strain of the COVID virus, although that has long since disappeared from circulation. The results were broadly welcomed by experts who agreed Moderna's vaccine is now the front runner as a booster, though some gave a note of caution until the trials are completed. The World Trade Organization says an international agreement on waiving intellectual property rights for COVID-19 vaccines is within reach. That statement comes days before trade ministers from around the world gather at the WTO's headquarters in Geneva. Sources say recent disagreements on that move center on the scope of the waiver and China's objection to some of the agreement's wording. But they add it is possible for them to clean that up. The WTO's biennial meeting was twice delayed by COVID-19. It's also taking place against the backdrop of high geopolitical tensions fueled by Russia's invasion of Ukraine. The Philippines' health chief claims the country has now contained the threat of COVID-19. Secretary Francisco Duque III says daily cases did not see a spike despite mass gatherings during the election campaign season. But Duque still urges the public to remain cautious as the virus may further mutate.
So far, given our measures, our interventions, mukhang contained na siya, no? And the data will support that claim. But at the same time, we are realistic to accept the fact that this virus is notorious for mutations. It is capable of springing surprises at every turn.
Duque, meanwhile, rejected calls to shut borders amid the monkeypox threat. But he adds he has ordered strict monitoring and surveillance for the virus.
It is premature to be closing borders to travelers from these endemic areas. Ang utos ko last May 7 sa BOQ is to be very strict, to enforce strict screening standards, symptom screening. No? Galing sa mga endemic countries or non-endemic countries with risk of monkeypox, dapat alamin yung symptoms.
Over 1,000 cases of the monkeypox virus have been detected in 29 non-endemic countries. The World Health Organization says the risk of monkeypox being established in these non-endemic countries is real, but it does not recommend a mass vaccination against the virus, adding no deaths have been so far reported from the outbreaks. Monkeypox is endemic in 9 African countries, but dozens of cases have sprung up in North America and Europe. Greece on Wednesday became the latest country to confirm its first case. The initial symptoms of monkeypox include a high fever, swollen lymph nodes, and a blistery chickenpox-like rash. The epidemic threshold for dengue already exceeded in 3 Philippine provinces. These are Cagayan, Isabela, and Nueva Vizcaya. The local health official says the number of dengue cases in the whole of Region 2 increased by more than 800% during the early part of this year from the same period in 2021. He cites increased mobility and the rainy season as the primary factors for the outbreak.
Nakalimutan na natin po yung nag-search and destroy ng Aedes breeding cases natin kasi nakatuon na tayo sa COVID lang tayo nakatukod. We have already coordinated with the different SBUs to start their 4S strategies. Yung 4S strategies po is some is search and destroy operations of Aedes breeding areas.
Mm-hmm.
Then yung second S is seek early consultation when you have the signs and symptoms of fever, headache, body pain, abdominal pain, vomiting. Then, self-protective clothing.
The Philippine Health Department says it has given its regional offices additional funds to cope with a spike in dengue cases. And before we go, a rare sighting of the outgoing Philippine leader causes a frenzy in the streets of Davao del Norte. President Rodrigo Duterte was quite literally stopped in his tracks on board his 3-wheeled motorcycle. That's after he was swarmed by residents in the city of Tagum. 2 weeks ago, Duterte also took his bike for a spin in the city of Digos, Davao del Sur. That's as he prepares to wrap up his 6-year term by June 30th. And that's the rundown. I'm Nikki De Guzman. We'll be back at 11 with more news. Keep it here on ANC.
Quarantine methods, no, and we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's going to prove to be better for demand. If we do follow the health protocols, the ability of people to move around will likely contribute better to growth.